This is an exciting session. We're going to have our keynote address from Baroness Hale. I've been given very clear instructions by your president. With his customary clarity, he said that it is absolutely essential that the session finishes no later than 5:30 because of the need to get to the drinks in Magdalen. But we are going to... Well, he told me that it was in Magdalen, and the program says it's in Magdalen, and if it's been changed, it's been changed. Well... So, the president is clear... but inaccurate. I have the email. Anyway, this is the second session on statute law today. Legislation or judicial reform, where should judges fear to tread? It's wonderful to have Baroness Hale to give this keynote address because I can't think of anybody with more hands-on experience in all sorts of different capacities on the topic. As a distinguished academic dealing in family law and mental health law in Manchester, a law commissioner for 9 years until 1994 when she was appointed to the family division, a stellar career as a judge, going to the Court of Appeal in 1999 and in 2004 to the House of Lords, and then when the House of Lords morphed into the Supreme Court, moving across the square. It's not surprising that statute has been given such a prominent position today, given that your president is a former law commissioner and he's infiltrated former law commissioner and law commission chairs into various functions. So the arrangement this afternoon is that Baroness Hale will speak for about 40 to 45 minutes. Professor Stevens will respond or comment for about 50 minutes. And subject to the rule laid down, there'll be up to 30 minutes for comments, questions, and discussion. And so without any more ado, I introduce Baroness Hale.
Jack, for the introduction and for making them all laugh, because for the next 40 to 45 minutes, I have no intention of making you laugh whatsoever. James Lee, who is here this afternoon, set me a challenge in his paper on the etiquette of law reform at the seminar held last year to celebrate 50 years since the creation of the Law Commissions. And the book has just been published. And he's just given me a copy. He didn't know that it was completely contemporary and that I was going to refer to it, but here it is, and please do buy it if you haven't already read it. So, anyway, chapter 29 is James's chapter. Why, he asked, was the Law Commission's competence a factor against judicial development of the law on prenuptial agreements in Radmacher and Gramatino? Or, he might more pertinently have asked, on witness immunity in Jones and Caney, but not similarly a factor in the joint ownership cases of Stack and Dowden and Jones and Kernott. Well, generally, I respect the judicial motto, never explain, never apologise, judgment speaks for itself. But James has asked a fair question, and I will try and give it a fair answer. But the wider question is, when should a judge feel free to develop, change, or reform the law rather than leaving it to Parliament? In trying to answer both of those questions, please forgive me for concentrating on cases in which I have been involved. They're the only ones I know these days. It's the perils of being a judge and not an academic. Now, there is a tendency among some law students, but not, of course, amongst members of this society, to think of Stack and Dowden and Jones and Kernot as family law cases concerned with discretionary property adjustment when an unmarried couple's relationship breaks down. They were no such thing. They were property law cases concerned with deducing the intentions of the parties as to their beneficial interests in a family home, which was conveyed into their joint names. Whether there should be financial and property adjustment remedies available between unmarried couples is quintessentially a law reform project conducted by the law commissions both north and south of the border, leading to similar solutions which have been implemented by legislation in Scotland, but not yet, or possibly ever, in England and Wales. They both envisaged a brand new remedy unlike anything there had been before. The project raised the empirical issue of how far the need for such a remedy could be demonstrated. It raised the fundamental policy question of how far the remedies available to unmarried couples should be assimilated to or different from those available to married couples. It required the principles underlying such a remedy to be worked out in detail. It required a statutory scheme to give effect to those principles. In short, that was a project for which the techniques established by the law commissions were particularly well suited. Research, consultation, consensus building, careful attention to working out the details. To my mind, but I accept that it was only my mind, according binding force to prenuptial agreements, as the majority did in Radmacher and Granatino, was the same sort of project. Admittedly, the original policy argument against doing so, that it encourages marital breakdown if spouses have agreed in advance what the consequences of their separation shall be, has lost much of its force. These days, marital breakdown is not regarded as something to be discouraged at all costs. It carries little, if any, social stigma, and the law is no longer concerned to use matrimonial remedies as a punishment for the crime of breaking up. These days, there's much to be said for the couple knowing in advance where they will stand if things go wrong. The problem is that the object of such agreements, at least in this country, by which I mean England and Wales, is to deprive one of the spouses of the divorce settlement to which he or she would otherwise be entitled. It is to limit rather than to enhance the claim. Now, there may be good reasons for this, but there's also a strong public interest in ensuring that people who can afford to provide for needs which have arisen from their marriages are obliged to do so. And other common law countries which have recognised the validity of prenuptial agreements have also recognised the need for procedural safeguards. Even if there's no inequality of bargaining power, people intending to marry are not always in the most rational or commercially astute frame of mind. At least I hope they're not. At the very least, they need full disclosure of the resources upon which they might otherwise have a claim. They need independent legal advice as to the effect of the agreement, what they are gaining and what they are giving up, whether there should be break clauses or renegotiation should circumstances change. None of this comes cheap. But the devising of limits and safeguards such as these is exactly the sort of thing which is better suited to a legislative scheme than to judicial lawmaking. I also took the view that the same applied to lifting the immunity of expert witnesses from actions in negligence brought by their clients in Jones and Caney. That involved, of course, a particularly egregious piece of professional negligence. Hard cases do make, it might be thought occasionally, not good law. It's easy to see why the majority thought that the claimant should have a cause of action. But giving him one was to open a Pandora's box without a thorough examination of the arguments or a carefully designed scheme to flesh out the details. Which actions, which experts, which clients, which activities, and in which circumstances should the immunity be lifted? The policy arguments in favour of witness immunity are not the same as the policy arguments in favour of advocates' immunity, but it appears that it was the removal of the latter which convinced the majority that it was appropriate to remove the former. I do accept, however, this case was very close to the borderline, and I certainly deeply regret any offence that I may have caused by calling the majority's decision irresponsible. (Laughter)
I can be rude sometimes, but I don't mean to be.
Of course, Lord Nichols and I might equally have been thought irresponsible in OBG and Allen. But I'm unrepentant. It was our view that the tort of conversion should be extended to intangible as well as tangible property. This was not to create a new court, tort or a new remedy. It was not to remove a long-held immunity granted on public policy grounds. It was to recognise that in modern times, the debts owed to you by your creditors are just as much your property as the cash under the bed and should be protected by proprietary as well as contractual remedies. If the debt represented by a cheque can be converted, why not debts represented in other ways? That was our thinking. The majority thought that it should all be left to Parliament. Stack and Dowden and Jones and Curnock were similarly an exercise in adapting well-established principles of the common law to meet modern circumstances. As Lord Reed suggested in Hedley Byrne and Heller, the law ought so far as possible to reflect the standards of the reasonable man, or even, of course, woman. The reasonable person would assume that if a home is put into joint names, the couple intend to own it jointly, unless there's a good reason to think otherwise. The competing presumptions of advancement and resulting trust were themselves an attempt to reflect what the reasonable man would assume the intentions of the parties or party to be. Unfortunately, the House of Lords had declined to remove the sexism in the presumption of advancement when they might have done so in Pettit and Pettit. But if there'd been no Matrimonial Causes Act giving proprietary remedies on divorce, I think that the courts would have had little difficulty in assuming that, at least when it came to the family home, joint meant joint. The most commonly cited reason for putting a home into joint names is the right of survivorship. There cannot at one and the same time be an intention to hold jointly and an intention to hold in unequal shares. This is not to say that intentions can't change over time. The only truly innovative feature of these decisions was to recognise this in what Lord Hoffman referred to as the ambulatory constructive trust. So that is how I try to defend myself against any charge of inconsistency. But should we distinguish between the incremental development of the law in this way and deliberately changing it, particularly where it has been decided at the highest level? We have just had a trilogy of cases in which the Supreme Court has done just that. First to be handed down was the Queen against Jogi, I think that's how it's pronounced, where we decided that the criminal law had taken a wrong turning in the Privy Council in Chan Wing Siu and the Queen, adopted by the House of Lords in the Powell and English cases. If two people set out to commit crime A and one of them committed crime B, the other was guilty as an accessory to crime B if he foresaw that it might happen, even if he did not intend it to do so. This was a new principle, and which the judgment says is based on an incomplete and in some respects erroneous reading of the previous case law, coupled with generalised and questionable policy arguments. Well, what's new? Happens all the time. We had had the benefit of a much fuller analysis. It couldn't be said that the law was now well established and working satisfactorily. If the law had taken a wrong turn, it should be corrected. Adopting mere foresight as a test for the mental element in murder was a serious and anomalous departure from the basic rule, and it required a lower mental threshold for guilt in an accessory than for the principal. In short, the courts having got the law into this mess, it was for the courts to sort it out rather than leave it to Parliament. Now, Jogi is an interesting cautionary tale, isn't it? It's a later case which is critical of the judicial lawmaking in an earlier case, where it was now clear that the courts had developed the common law without proper consideration of the underlying principles or of the policy arguments in favour of extending criminal liability in this way. Next in the trilogy came Naur and the Ministry of Justice, which involved departure from previous House of Lords decisions in Cookson and Knowles and Graham and Dodds. The issue is whether the multiplier for calculating the financial loss suffered by dependents after a wrongful death should be measured from the date of trial or from the date of death. Really important stuff. Not very important to academics, but incredibly important to practitioners. It affects a lot of people. The normal approach used in non-fatal injuries is to calculate the actual losses up to the date of trial and award a lump sum for those, and then to calculate future losses by applying a multiplier to a multiplicand. The multiplier reflects the normal life expectancy of the deceased, based on actuarial tables, which include a discount to take effect of the so-called vicissitudes of life, and also a discount to reflect the benefit of getting a lump sum now to cater for the losses which would have been suffered over a number of years in the future. Calculating the multiplier from the date of death rather than the date of trial applies this discount for early receipt, even though part of the sum has not been received earlier. The case in question, this made a difference of over £52,000 to Mrs. Nower's widower. Everyone, including counsel for the defendant, who I'm glad to say is a Manchester barrister true to the best traditions of the Manchester Bar, agreed that this was all wrong in principle, a departure from the normal principle of full compensation, no more but no less. But could the courts put it right? This was not so much a case of a wrong turning in the past case, but a case where times have moved on. The House of Lords decisions which had adopted the date of death were long before the Ogden actuarial tables, which are now used to calculate future losses, had been developed and approved by the courts. The assessment of damages was a much less sophisticated scheme, science than that now is. Not only had the legal landscape changed, but the court also had the benefit of a thorough investigation and analysis by the Law Commission. This had recommended that the law be changed, but that there was room for judicial manoeuvre without legislation. The assessment of damages had always been a matter for the courts rather than the legislature, with some exceptions. As in Jogi, the law had been made by the judges, and if shown to be defective, it should be corrected or brought up to date by the judges unless there was a good reason to the contrary. So we did. Now, both of these were unanimous decisions and probably uncontroversial, at least among lawyers. The same cannot be said of the most recent of the three, Patel and Mirza, and I suspect that Professor Stevens may have something to say about that decision. This was a 9-judge court convened to try and resolve the differences of opinion as to the scope and rationale of the illegality defence, which had emerged in the earlier Supreme Court cases of Hunger and Allen, in which I was involved, Les Laboratoires Servier and Apotex, in which I wasn't, and Bilter and Nazir, also in which I wasn't involved. One side favoured the reliance rule in Tinsley and Milligan. If you could plead your claim without relying on the illegality, you could recover. If not, not. The other side favoured an integrity of the legal system approach, actually borrowed from Canada, as in so much else in the common law. What was the purpose of the prohibition which had been transgressed? Would it enhance that purpose to deny the claim? Are the countervailing public policies? Would it be proportionate to deny the claim? The latter approach prevailed by a majority of 6-3. But in fact, we would all have allowed the actual claim in question. Mr. Patel had handed over a large sum of money to Mr. Mirza for the purpose of a proposed insider dealing transaction proposed by Mr. Mirza, which never took place. We all thought that Mr. Patel was entitled to his money back. It didn't actually promote the cause of justice for the principal wrongdoer, Mr. Mirza, to be able to hang on to it. So, once again, as with Knauer, this was a case in which the Law Commission had encouraged the courts to develop the law. After a prolonged investigation of the illegality defence, it had declined to recommend legislative reform in relation to a contract or tort on the grounds that the court seemed to be developing the law in the right direction. That was, of course, before the differences of opinion had emerged in Hunger, Les Laboratoires and Bilter. This was clearly an area of judge-made law where the judges had got us into a mess and Parliament was most unlikely to get us out of it. A thorough investigation by the Law Commission was a great help to us in trying to do so. So how are we to make up our minds?
whether an issue is suitable for development by the judges or whether it should be left to Parliament. Theoretically, an outdated or unjust law can always be corrected by Parliament these days. But there are problems with relying either on the judges or on Parliament. Problems with the judges. There are many objections to the judges developing the law, but the most powerful one, in my view, is the character of litigation itself. As the great R.E. McGarry said, argued law is tough law. He said that in the course of a case in which he reached a conclusion which was contrary to the conclusion for which he had argued in previous academic writing. So that's why he was saying that. He was also adapting F.W. Maitland's taught law, T-A-U-G-H-T, law is tough law. Now that's a compliment to the members of this society, is it not? The law you teach is tough. When an issue has been thrashed out in adversarial argument between two or more parties to whom the result really matters, any judge is more likely to appreciate the pros and cons of any particular outcome than if he had simply investigated it for himself. Any judge who's read one side's written argument and thought, well, that seems pretty convincing, knows perfectly well that it will seem much less convincing once he has read the other side, and different again when each side has had the opportunity of debating it with the judge at the oral hearing. Maybe so. But the parties are not debating the issue in order to promote the just and orderly development of the law. Far from it. They are doing so in order to achieve the result that they want. It is usually they who frame the issues. In our court, we require them to agree a statement of facts and issues. They will then usually choose which materials and arguments to deploy. It's rare for a court to decide a case on the basis of an argument which has not been deployed by the parties. If the court is inclined to decide the case on a completely fresh basis, it is customary to give the parties an opportunity of commenting. Argued law is tougher law, and judicial research is not infallible. Not that it is always easy to decide whether the basis is completely fresh. It may have been briefly touched upon in the argument, or it may simply be a different way of analysing the materials which have been presented. So it isn't always done, but most of the time it is. So most of the time, the case is decided on the arguments presented by the parties. The court may even refer to the fact that no one has argued something else or disputed a particular proposition. So the court is adopting it for the sake of this particular argument or case. And each party may have had their reasons, not necessarily the same reasons, for not disputing a particular proposition or opening up a particular line of argument. Busy courts encourage them to focus on their best points. So they concentrate on the ones they think most likely to win them the case. And they leap on any olive branch offered them by the court, which gives them the best result they can hope for. Added to this, the parties usually have neither the will nor the resources to research the background, facts and policy arguments, whether of legal or social or economic or any other kind of policy. In Jones and Kernot, for example, we were referred to none of the extensive academic literature which had both preceded and followed Stack and Dowden. We had to consult it ourselves. It's difficult for the parties, at least until they get to our court, to know whether the court will be interested, either in academic commentary or in comparative law. Dare I say it, Lord Justice Beetson, it will depend on the panel that you encounter in the Court of Appeal, whether it is worth your while to spend money doing such a thing. We usually are interested, but it takes skill and resources to research them properly. Fortunately, there seems to be a growing trend for parties to recruit academic lawyers to their legal teams, which certainly happened in both Jogi and in Patel. As well as the limitations of the adversarial process, there are the limitations of the judiciary. I'm so old that I remember being in the audience for Lord Reed's famous lecture to the Society of Public Teachers of Law on the judge as lawmaker. This was in September 1971. How many people here were also there? Wow, I really am old, aren't I? Yes. It was in Edinburgh. There, This is where he exploded the fairy tale that judges simply discover rather than make the common law. But he went on to say that where there was scope for judges to mould the development of the common law, they should have regard to common sense, legal principle, and public policy in that order. Well, I have no problem with legal principle. That seems to me the main basis on which we should be developing the law. Hence, if criminal liability is in principle based on subjective intention, or sometimes recklessness, it was wrong to substitute foresight for intention. But I have terrible problems with common sense. Once upon a time, I was rude enough to say that one man's common sense is another woman's hopeless idiocy. I was referring, or I had in mind, the 19th century rule that complaints of statutory rape had to be brought within 3 months, that is, before any pregnancy became apparent. The thinking was that once a pregnancy became apparent, the victim was so likely to lie about the perpetrator that a prosecution would be unsafe. Even though, of course, the pregnancy demonstrated beyond doubt that she had indeed been a victim of the crime. And not all statutory rapes result in pregnancy. I'm not, of course, arguing that judges shouldn't use their common sense, merely that they should not mistake their own prejudices and preconceptions for it. Public policy is also a necessary but dangerous consideration. It has so many different meanings. It can simply mean fairness as between different groups of people. If the spectators at Hillsborough who suffered psychiatric harm by witnessing the disaster as it unfurled were denied compensation, it would be wrong for the police officers who suffered the same harm for the same reason to be compensated. If, as Lord Reed seemed to think, public policy refers to keeping in step with public opinion, going to the grassroots, then there is no machinery for the judges to find out what this is. Inquiries among their own social circle are unlikely to be a reliable guide. At the Law Commission, we did occasionally conduct reasonably scientific studies of public opinion on a particular issue. It was very difficult to do this in a way which conveyed enough information to respondents for them to form reasonable opinions, but at least we could try. The judges can't do this, and neither, on the whole, can the parties. Although we do on occasions have such survey evidence, usually from NGO interveners who've conducted research for their own purposes, and very valuable it is too. But if public policy refers to resource implications in the widest possible sense, or to the likely effect upon people's behaviour of deciding a case in a particular way, as the judges often seem to think it does, then again they rarely have reliable information about this. In Michael and the Chief Constable of South Wales Police, for example, the issue was the liability of the police for the negligent mishandling of a 999 call, thus failing to prevent the murder of a young mother by her former partner. In the earlier cases on the scope of the police duty of care in the prevention and investigation of crime, the impact on police resources and behaviour of widening their potential liability had loomed large. Most of those arguments were exploded. And not only because the police remain potentially liable under the Human Rights Act if death results. While I didn't agree with the majority in the result, I was glad to see that their reasoning relied much more heavily on legal principle, the general principles governing liability for omissions and liability for the misdeeds of third parties, than on such public policy arguments. There are other disadvantages in judicial law reform. The law should be clear and predictable, especially if people have for many years been basing their transactions or their behaviour on a particular understanding of what it is. Judges should be slow to change that understanding, although it's not unknown. Once upon a time, when judges were a relatively homogenous group who led somewhat cloistered lives, some of them still do, it may well have been that, if called upon to decide a new issue or to develop the law in a particular way, it was reasonably predictable how they might do this. Their reputation for impartiality and neutrality was not endangered by their doing so. They may have been, to borrow Will Carling's phrase, boring old farts, but at least they were predictably boring old farts. But once judges become a more diverse group, with a wider range of background, experience, and philosophy, Their approach to particular issues might also become more diverse and thus less predictable. Might this endanger the reputation of the judiciary as a whole for impartiality and neutrality? We don't want it thought that the identity of the individual judge or the composition of the particular panel deciding the case will make a difference to the outcome, do we? Finally, it is argued that if the judges put right the worst injustices or anomalies in the law, there is less incentive for Parliament to legislate for a comprehensive and properly worked out solution. This was, for example, an objection to the incremental development of the law on conversion, which Lord Nicholls and I favoured in Obergey and Allen. And of course, it was my objection to the Radmacher and Granatino development, but there we go. But that leads us to the problems with leaving it to Parliament to develop the law. Anyone who's ever had anything to do with the work of the law commissions will have grasped how hard it is to develop or reform the common law by legislation. The easiest route may simply be abolition. But even this is not simple, because you have first to define what it is that you are abolishing. When I first arrived at the Law Commission, I thought I knew what the parole evidence rule was and that it ought to be abolished. But the Commission had decided that there was nothing to abolish. All it meant was that if the parties had agreed that their writing would contain the whole of their agreement, neither should be allowed to adduce evidence that it contained something else. If they had not so agreed, there was no objection to their adducing parole evidence as to the true contents of their agreement. Now, some of us would have preferred a simple little statute making this clear to lesser mortals who had a simpler view of the law. But this view did not prevail. But the problems of abolition are nothing compared with the problems of reform. It begins with formulating your proposals. First, you have to decide what the law is. Then you have to decide how it should be changed. Then you have to persuade parliamentary counsel to find the words to express this clearly and precisely enough for the parties and the judges who'll have to apply it in the future. Deciding what the law is may not be so difficult where there are clear decisions of the House of Lords or Supreme Court directly in point, but it is much harder where there's a mass of Court of Appeal and High Court authority which has to be reconciled and, more to the point, may well change before your proposed reforms are implemented or even while you're in progress. The problems continue if your proposals are put before Parliament. The democratic process may wreak havoc with your carefully thought out and coherent scheme. Family lawyers amongst you will know what I'm talking about. Yeah? Part 2 of the Family Law Act 1996 on the ground for divorce. Not only that, once done, legislative reform freezes the law in a particular place and prevents its incremental development on a case-by-case basis. Indeed, if Parliament has legislated on one assumption as to what the law is, for example, the tort of conversion is limited to chattels, this may be seen as a barrier to challenging that assumption, as it was in OBG. Even when it's quite clear what the law is and how it should be changed, Parliament may be reluctant to spend precious time on it. Reforming the common law is not a high priority for government or politicians. The Law Commission has recently tried hard both to gain government buy-in before a project is undertaken and to obtain a timely response once it is completed. This has worked well in some areas, most notably, I think, where the statute book is in a mess, but it has worked less well in areas where the common law has proved inadequate and statutory reform is needed, financial remedies between cohabiting couples being an example. Worst of all, there are some areas where the judges are all too well aware of their own inadequacies and would dearly love Parliament to solve the problem for them. Switching off life support or withdrawing artificial nutrition and hydration is an obvious example. In the Tony Bland case, Lord Bramwin Wilkinson said it's not for the judges to seek to develop new all-embracing principles in a way which reflects the individual judge's moral stance, when society as a whole is substantially divided on the relevant moral issues. It seemed to him imperative that the issue should be considered in Parliament, and the judge's function should be to apply the principles adopted through the democratic process. Well, yes, Parliament did have a select committee of the House of Lords which looked at the matter and said, no, law's fine, no need for any legislation. So There, the judges were left to carry on as before. What is the judge to do if Parliament resolutely refuses to intervene? Unlike Parliament, the judge does not have a do-nothing option. The judge has to decide the case. So, of course, that's what the judges have been doing with the Tony Blann cases ever since. And indeed, what they have been doing is deducing the common law principles and applying them to the situation. And in fact, although they were deeply uncomfortable about it in the Tony Blann case, it's not too difficult to work out what those principles are. So, is there an answer to the question I set at the outset? Well, I agree with Lord Dyson, who said it twice in his Alba lecture and in his Bentham Association presidential address, that there is no one principled answer, but the overall key is institutional competence. This is not the same as democratic legitimacy. In our unwritten constitution, it is accepted that both Parliament and the judges may make the law. It's also accepted that Parliament can make or unmake any law. On the other hand, it is accepted that there are limits to the lawmaking role of the courts. Those limits are set by what a court, in deciding the individual case before it, is competent to do. However, as Lord Dyson points out, some judges are more adventurous and take a broader view of their competence than others. We have to acknowledge that the judge often does have a choice about whether to develop the law or whether to leave it alone. And that, in a sense, is the biggest objection to judicial law reform. If there are two possible answers to a case, why should the judge be choosing one rather than the other? But I do think, very swiftly, there are at least six things which the courts are competent to do in an appropriate case. First, they can discern and articulate a general principle or principles from a mass of individual instances, as the majority did, for example, in Donoghue and Stevenson. Second, they may adopt the general principles already discerned by great doctrinal writers who have done the job for them and apply these to new cases, as has certainly happened in the law of restitution. Third, they may expand an existing concept, such as personal injury, bodily harm, or domestic violence, to reflect modern thinking and understanding of those concepts. Fourth, they may develop the scope of an existing cause of action. For example, by expanding liability and negligence for failing to inform patients of the risks and benefits in certain treatments, or by recognizing that the tort of malicious prosecution can apply to bringing civil as well as criminal proceedings. Fifth, they may develop the scope of existing remedies, for example, by decreeing an increase in the level of damages for pain, suffering, and loss of immunity, as happened in Harlan Rankin, or by recognising new heads of damages for personal injury, or by altering the basis of calculation, as we did in Nauer. And sixthly, they may even invent brand new remedies to support an existing cause of action. Obvious examples are Morava injunctions and Anton Piller orders, but my favourite, well, it would be, wouldn't it, is Rees and the Darlington Memorial Hospital NHS Trust, where the majority invented a brand new award of a non-negligible but non-compensatory sum to recognise the invasion of autonomy and bodily integrity involved in causing a woman to have a child she should never have had. That was done by four out of the seven law lords. Three of them thought she should have the money, have compensation. Those are six things I think judges can, in an appropriate case, do. Never say never, but I think the judges are unlikely to create an entirely new cause of action, and certainly not these days a new criminal offence. This they would now regard themselves as institutionally incompetent to do, even if they might have done it in the past, when Parliament was less active and there were no law commissions to show how it should be done. But I just leave you with one question. Is that right? Should they be so cautious? What about Kay and Robinson and the invasion of privacy? Do you remember the case of the LOLO star who had a serious accident and was lying in his hospital bed with all tubes all over the place and barely conscious. And the reporter and photographer burst into his hotel, hospital room, despite notices on the door saying, no, they shouldn't. They took photographs of him, and what they wanted to do was publish them along with an interview, which he was clearly in no fit state to give. They could be prevented by the tort of malicious falsehood from pretending that he had agreed to give the interview, but they could not be prevented from publishing the photographs or what they said he had said. So why couldn't the tort of intentionally causing harm have been developed to cover such a situation, as it had previously been developed to cover similarly outrageous behaviour in Janvier and Sweeney? Why did it take the Human Rights Act to bring about such a development, and thus to earn it the media's opprobrium? I wish it was the common law rather than the Human Rights Act that earned the media's opprobrium. Thank you.
That was such a wonderful talk with so much food for thought and so many different areas, so that when we get to the discussion, somebody will be able to pick something from their own experience, diverse as it is. I, in what the former professor of criminology at Cambridge called my weak management style, my weak consensus-driven management style, I'm now going to hand over to Professor Stevens for commentary, which I'm sure will be equally stimulating, and then we'll move to the discussion, and I may or may not take the chairman's prerogative at that point.
Baroness Hale, Lord Justice Beetson, ladies and gentlemen. Well, it's absolutely an honour to be asked to do a reply, and it's extremely intimidating for reasons which have already become apparent why it is so intimidating. I'm very grateful for our illustrious president for telling me that I'm doing this reply. Now, all academics, all of us fantasise about being a sort of final court of appeal from our ultimate appellate court, and this is basically as close as I'm ever going to get. So that's rather attractive. Now, I take it as a given that the nominal or notional sums of money we are paid as members of universities to do our job doesn't mean that what we're expected to do with that is simply to agree and report on what the members of the senior judiciary do. And so I'm not going to dwell very long on the large areas where all of us will have to agree with what we've been said. So what, for example, was said about common sense and public policy left me, at least, with a warm, lovely glow of appreciation. But my starting point is going to be slightly different in the sense that what I want to ask is, how is the common law, which is essentially entirely judge-made, legitimate at all? Yeah, and so once we've answered the question, how is this legitimate, that we've got this body of law which the judges have made, from there we might be able to answer, well, what's the capacity they have for amending it as they see fit? Now, one of the important points to notice, which we've already seen in Baroness Hale's talk, is that the judges don't perceive of themselves as being a sort of subsidiary part of the legislature. So that the sorts of reasons that they give for the rules that they lay down are quite different from the sorts of reasons that a legislator would give. So we don't find legislators giving extensive quotations from earlier judges or saying this is what they do in the Supreme Court of Canada. They don't give a damn. Yeah, but our judges, even in our Supreme Court, who are not bound by earlier judges, do rely on those kinds of reasons, so that they clearly see themselves as engaged in a completely different endeavour from being a branch of the legislature. Now, one of the reasons why they use different reasons from that of a legislator is the importance of certainty. So Lord Hoffman in a case called Cambridge Water stated that although he might be prepared to say that the rule in Rylands and Fletcher was wrong, it would be inconsistent with the judicial function at this point to overturn the rule. And he said much the same thing in a case called Chartbrook about the rule that pre-contractual negotiations were inadmissible in relation to interpreting an agreement. The idea being that, okay, starting with a blank page, we might not have these rules, but it's too late now. The importance of certainty and precedence within our legal system means that, okay, he may have the power. He may have the power to get rid of this rule, but it would be illegitimate and wrong for him to exercise the power at this stage in our development. Now, we can see, indeed, from some of the examples Baroness Hale gave us, that there's the scope to which you're going to place weight, put weight on that idea of certainty will differ. So there will be some cases where you say, well, actually, this decision is so badly wrong, or this rule is so badly wrong, we're going to overturn it. And that really does give rise to a question of judgment. But what I'm going to suggest is, in addition to this idea of certainty, there are other really more basic reasons why the range of reasons which judges can give for the decisions they come to are actually much more restricted than that which a legislature can use. So, let me give some familiar objections, some of which we've already heard, to the common law itself. So, a couple of objections we've already heard include, for example, the lack of democratic legitimacy. How is it that these unelected, visibly unelected people have the power to lay down laws for us? Indeed, most of the common law was laid down by now long dead, almost all white, almost all men. And if you're Australian or Canada, they were foreigners. So have these people got any legitimacy to have laid down our laws for us? And another problem is, of course, their competence. So the range of considerations that a legislature will bring into account in their setting down rules, considering, for example, the economic impact of rules of competition and so on, those sorts of considerations, unfortunately, are not within the range of competence of our judiciary. They aren't trained as macroeconomists. They don't have the skill set to bring into account these reasons. How are they supposed to be behaving in the same way that a legislature would? Other problems with the common law. So, just as an example, our rules on causation. So if anybody tries to teach the law of causation, the law of torts nowadays, what the students are expected to do is plough through dozens and dozens of cases, hundreds of pages in length, with the members of the judiciary stating completely different things, and then try to make sense of all of this stuff. Yeah, well, that, I'm afraid, is really just not consistent with the rule of law any longer. The idea that our law should be that inaccessible and that difficult to grasp is very unfortunate indeed. Indeed, one of the further problems with the common law is it can always be overturned. So it's always possible that however certain I am about what the common law says at this given moment in time, it may be that we go up all the way to the Supreme Court and the judges up there disagree and overturn it and change everything. See Patel against Mertzer. So in a way, I have a great deal of sympathy with Bentham, not somebody I ordinarily want to cite as a figure of authority, in relation to the difficulties we've got with the common law and its legitimacy. Okay, we may not be able to remove all of judge-made law, but why shouldn't it be the case that what we should be trying to do is get rid of as much of it as we can, put as much of it onto the statute book as we possibly can, then thereby all being readily accessible by Google to anybody? It's surely much, much preferable to this judge-made stuff, which with the problems we've already seen. But what I want to then suggest is that there's actually something peculiarly valuable and different about judge-made law, that judge-made law is of a different sort from some of the law created by a legislature, and that we ought to be careful in doing that. So, say we started, make a mind game, say we start with a blank page, we've got no laws at all, and what we do is we get a couple of judges, we say, go forth and do justice. And they've got no rules at that point. They've got nothing. They've just got a blank sheet of paper. What can they do? Well, one view of the judicial function is, or what they do, is that they operate as a legislature would, that they try and bring into account the full range of considerations as to how to improve society. So they think about what would be the economically optimal result, what rules would deter people from acting in certain ways, what kind of society do we want? Well, if that's the way that the judges are behaving, the entire common law is simply illegitimate. And that actually then we need to put it onto a statutory footing as quickly as we can. But I don't think that is the way that the common law is made. The answer I would suggest is that the legal rights we have, which are judge-made, are necessarily minimalist in character or basic because judge-created. So what are these minimal or basic sets of rights that we have one against another? Well, if we had no rights at all, we had none, that would mean that we were free to kill one another. It would mean we were able to shout fire in crowded theatres and so on. So all of our rights inhibit one another's liberty of action. Now, in order for us to be free from interference by others, we must all have rights restricting others from behaving towards us in certain ways. And these rights are acquired by equal freedom. Now, what are these rights? Well, you must not tell me lies, I believe. You must keep the agreements you make. You may not burn down my crops or enter my home. You must not damage my reputation with others. And pretty much that's it. Now, of course, this minimal or basic set of rights needs to be given a certain level of determinatio or rigidity by the judges. And that, in a sense, is their job, is to try and say, well, where does one person's land begin and end? You know, when is it permissible to go and damage some person's reputation where what you're saying is true? And that's what they've been doing. That's the game they've been playing for centuries in giving our minimal basic set of rights determination and rigidity. But what could they not do? What could they not do? Well, let me give you some examples of rights which aren't like that. So I'll give you two contrasting examples. First set of examples are intellectual property rights. So it's perfectly possible to imagine a civilized society which allowed the copying of works of art. If you have a Picasso and you copy it, you've got two beautiful paintings, not one. Yeah, so it's perfectly possible to imagine a perfectly civilized society which doesn't have a law of copyright. And there are people who campaign in, the Pirate Party and so on to try and get the law of copyright overturned. Yeah, and the justifications we've got for the law of copyright are all instrumental, that it encourages people like Picasso to go and create works of art. Similarly with trademarks, the justifications we've got for trademarks are instrumental, enables us as consumers to buy particular things, securing the knowledge that that sort of thing will have a particular quality. Patents are similar, they have instrumental justifications to encourage innovation. Now those are all instrumental justifications for those rights, and those sorts of justifications are the sorts of justifications these people cannot use. They can't do that. And so that's why that category of rights was all created by the legislature. These were all legislative in source, and they're not the basic minimal set. No, they're not the set that the judges can make. Another example, rather more controversial example, the Human Rights Act 1998. Now, the label human rights, that label, lays claim to the idea that these rights are human in the sense of the category of rights we have simply by virtue of being human, that no further justification essentially needs to be made. Yeah? Now, that's wrong. And the reason it's wrong is observably wrong. One reason it's wrong is because of the party against whom these rights are exigible. Human rights are exigible against the state. Yeah? Now, in order for them to exist, you need a state for them to be there. That means they cannot be the cast of rights which are true in all times and places. Cavemen, for example, had no right to education. They had no other person against whom that right was exigible. Now, we have a right to education under the Human Rights Act. Yeah? Good. Two thumbs up to that. But it can't be one of the rights that we have simply by virtue of being human. It can't be. Now, what is one way of illustrating the difference between our judge-made rights and how far they can go and those rights which are created by the legislature is the case of Michael against the Chief Constable of South Wales. So what happens in Michael is we have the police failing to respond to a 999 call. And as a result, Joanna Michael was murdered by her partner. And she sues the police. So start from my proposition. Do we have a right against other people that they come to our assistance? Do I have a right against you that you come and assist me and protect me against my murderous partner? And the answer to that question is no. Equal freedom doesn't require that. Yeah, so if I don't have it against you and you and you and you, do I have it against the police specifically? Well, the party who can give me a right against the police specifically to secure that is the legislature, not the judges. So when we ask at common law, can she sue kind of state sue at common law in the source of negligence for her death? The answer is correctly no. There is no claim here at common law. The judges cannot allow this claim. When we ask the question, is there a claim under the Human Rights Act, the answer is yes, and rightly yes. This is what the legislature has said, yeah, for good reasons. Is it enough in St. Michael to start from the proposition, as one of the judges did, that what the police have been negligent and as a result the victim has left worse off? We can't do that. That's not a legitimate way for the case to have been decided, nor can you proceed for the proposition, well, this was a breach of a public duty, therefore the person who's worse off can sue. That's not good enough either. This is a decision where the result is only legitimately mandated by the legislature. Now, Gordon Kay. I find Mr. Kay a very difficult case. But, I mean, in a way, trying to defend the Sunday Sport for their disgusting behaviour, a very difficult thing to do. What we have is we have a powerless, innocent victim, and we have swines who behave in the most revolting manner. But the result is, at common law, no claim. So, one of the questions we're asked is, why couldn't we have extended the rule that the intentional infliction of harm is actionable to cover and protect Mr. K? Well, I think there are a number of reasons. Number one, there's no ability at common law to bring a claim for the infliction of misery. Most of the people in this room are professionally employed in the infliction of misery on the young. Yeah? And fortunately for us, some of us are better than others, but fortunately for us, that isn't actionable at common law. Yeah, Wainwright in the Home Office. Why not? Well, one of the reasons why not is that making me miserable, if you deliberately make me miserable, that doesn't impede or inhibit my ability to lead my life. My ability to conduct my affairs is not infected by being made miserable, and worse off, undoubtedly. But no principle of equal freedom is infringed by allowing the law to say no actionability for the deliberate infliction of misery. Contrast that with the case of Janvier and Sweeney. So what we have in Janvier and Sweeney is the defendant had told the claimant that she was wanted for communicating with a German spy. This is during the First World War. And as a result of this, which was simply untrue, she suffered what was then called nervous shock, what we would, in modern parlance, call recognised psychiatric injury. Now, there's a basic and important difference between misery and psychiatric injury. If you cause me psychiatric injury, I cannot reason. I cannot reason any longer. So if what you do is you harm or damage my ability to reason, that inhibits my freedom to live my life. So this is caught by the equal freedom principle, that clearly we must have a right, good against other people, that you do not damage my ability to reason. And that's what's going on in Janvier and Sweeney. So that can't capture the Gordon Kay case. That isn't what happens to Gordon Kay. Gordon Kay wasn't driven mad by what happened when they came into the hospital bedroom. So if we're going to bring a claim here, what we'd have to recognise is a right to privacy. What we'd have to recognise is some sort of new right that others don't invade our privacy. Now, we know that that's what's now happened. We know that that's what's now happened. And the way that happened was in baby steps. So we have Campbell against Mirror Group newspapers, and then we have lots of other baby steps made by the Court of Appeal. And eventually we have recognised a more generalised right to privacy. And it's said that this is mandated by the Human Rights Act. The Human Rights Act gives us this right against the state to respect for our family life. That mandates and permits the recognition of a more general right at common law to privacy, good against everybody. I am doubtful about that proposition. And the only reason it looks legitimate is because we did it in baby steps and not one big one. So would we say that the fact that I have a right to education against the state under the Human Rights Act mandates the recognition of a right to education against everybody? The answer to that is no. There's all sorts of ways in which the state can protect that right in the same way as it could with the right to privacy. And so I'm extremely worried about that. So, final point. Who is to speak up? Who is to speak up when the judges go too far? Who is it whose job is to say, well, in Patel and Mertzer, when you change the law so that the law on illegality in this jurisdiction does not represent the law on illegality in any other jurisdiction in the common law world, it doesn't represent the law on illegality in Canada, that you've introduced a new rule which it's difficult to say doesn't require first instance judges to answer impossible question. Whose job is it to watch and say, well, no, this far and no further? Well, members of our society, it's our job. It's our job to say never. Sometimes you've got to say never. But unfortunately, not everybody believes in saying never. Okay, thank you very much.
When I was appointed to the bench under the old corrupt system,
as was I,
Lord Lloyd of Berwick said to me, he wrote me a very nice letter of congratulation, and he said he thought the last academic was Blackstone, and he turned into a terrible formalist, and he hoped that I wouldn't be like that. And I puzzled over all of this, but I think maybe Lord Lloyd would have been on the sharp end of comments by Professor Stevens, because he obviously thought there was much more freedom than there was, than there is. Now, I think that my chairman's perspective is a comparative perspective. It is clear that in the United States, there was a lot more development of common law and indeed principles of public law, judicially, because of legislative inertia. And that is a real problem. The Baroness Hale said it's not open to the judges to do nothing. They've got to give an answer. And if you're faced, as Lord Gough, who sadly his funeral was this week, was in Ray F, with a position in which there was no clear rule about whether what would happen on giving consent for a mentally incapacitated adult, you are between a rock and a hard place. And you could say, well, there is no rule on this, we can't do anything. You can make the law and let Parliament put it right if it's wrong. And that is the dilemma, I think. And one of my last comment before I throw it open is to say that I'm really delighted to hear all the examples that the two speakers gave. In the Court of Appeal, I spend a disproportionate amount of my time dealing with immigration cases. And therefore, I've been exposed, I think, to the worst body of legislative enactment, soft law, law that is so soft and liquid that you can't even call it soft law, law that cannot be accessed so that even those representing the government can't tell you which guidance was in force at the relevant date for your case. And as judges, we just have to do our best and we can make grumpy old men and women noises. It doesn't have any impact. But I think that the dynamic and the constitutional justification for a moderate approach by judges, as I think most judges have as to what they can and cannot do, does depend on the other organs of the state fulfilling their responsibility. And that I leave you with that. And now, here we are at 5:10, and I suspect that the president, or even though the president told me you were all going to Magdalen, you're going to LMH, which is even further away, he's apologized. Email is a wonderful thing. I sent him the email because he looked so unbelieving when I said it. But let's throw it open to comment, discussion, questions. And I don't know, in most meetings that I go to, people identify themselves when they first speak, and I've got a hand up there. I think there are roving mics, at least there's at least one roving mic. Is it going to be possible if the two speakers stay where they are for the camera to pan around and get them? I don't think it's fair for them to be like yo-yos coming and going. Yeah?
Rajiv Shah, University of Cambridge. I have a question for Baroness Hale about Jogi, I'm not quite sure how to pronounce it. Finlay Stark, in a forthcoming article in the Cambridge Law Journal, argues that the legal history adopted in the case was erroneous, and that actually, looking back at the cases of the past 500 years, we did have the parasitic liability rule, and that therefore what Chenwitzu was doing was simply reaffirming what had been the case for the past 500 years. Now, obviously, you haven't seen the paper, and I don't want to get into the debate of whether he's correct or not, but assuming for the sake of argument that he was correct, and assuming that Chenwitzu was not a mistake, but was simply reinstating what the law had been for 500 years, how would that have affected the legitimacy of what the Supreme Court did in Jogi?
I don't know the answer to that question, because obviously I haven't read the article, and I don't know the criticism of the historical research which was used for the basis of the judgment of Lords Toulson and Hughes in the Jogi case. We did do an awful lot of reading. There was a lot of support for their analysis of the previous. Of course, it was all complicated by the rule that you're presumed to intend the natural and probable consequences of your actions. And that makes it very difficult to interpret most of the previous case law until one gets to the, till after that had happened. That I would acknowledge, really difficult to do. The best I could say in my own defense was that I was A, satisfied with the analysis, and B, more than satisfied that the state of the law was wrong.
Jogi's great.
Now, I, some people who've indicated, I'm making a list of people who've indicated, and some of you I know your names and some I don't. I know Conor Gearty, but he was first, honest. So, Conor Gearty.
Thanks. My name is Conor Gearty, LSE. I have a question for both, actually, Baroness Hale and Professor Stevens, and I think it could be very shortly answered, actually. The Secretary of State for Justice has reaffirmed the intention to repeal, well, to introduce a new Bill of Rights, we'll say. But let's suppose the Human Rights Act is repealed and an effort is made to make sure that there isn't an equivalent right to privacy or right to respect for privacy in a follow-up bill. Can the case law on privacy survive repeal of the Human Rights Act? And this follow-up question, I'm particularly interested in Professor Stevens on this, ought it to survive? So can it survive and ought it survive?
You can't possibly expect me to answer that question.
He wasn't asking you.
And you know perfectly well that you can't possibly expect me to answer that question.
Well, it's difficult, isn't it, in the sense that the origin of much of this rule, if you go back to Campbell, what they say they're doing in Campbell, what they say in Campbell is that this is based upon, that the particular right in Campbell was based upon the old confidential information, and which was then originally dependent upon a confidential relationship, and then that requirement of a confidential relationship is removed, and then we acquire this right to private information, is what we thought the law was back in 2004. But now we know that isn't right. Now we've been told in the, I'm going to give the name of the pop singer, which I shouldn't, case. We now know that it's not to do with the information being confidential at all. So even though this information is all in the public domain, they will still grant an injunction restraining its publication. So that a rule which seems to have started off to do with the old law on confidential information is completely broken free of that basis. In baby steps, we've gone way away from the old law of confidential information and created an entirely new right. Now, the fact that they've done it in baby steps, does that make it okay that they've done it in baby steps? Well, no, it can't be okay just because you did it incrementally. If they did it in one big leap, that would be no better. So then the question is it okay because it was mandated by the Human Rights Act? Well, if we are saying the only reason, if that is our only reason we've got for saying this is legitimate, was the Human Rights Act, then if we get rid of it, not a very good idea, but if we did, then the justification for it goes. But what might be the case is it would force our judges to, instead of saying, okay, this is just an incremental development on this previous case, to give us the normative reasons, the real normative justifications for why they think this is justified, which they don't really do in these cases. You can, again being rude, you can read Campbell till the 100 times and you still won't find a really clear articulation of what they think the moral reason for the recognition of this right is. Yeah? And if you, as you were, are convinced that that moral reason is a good one and that it's the kind of reason that judges are legitimately able to recognise, then it can survive. Yeah? But if you think the only basis for it is the Human Rights Act, once it goes with it, would be my judgment.
Right, I'm going to ask the lady with the red toss. I'm going to have to identify people by clothes, but I'm going to make an interjection first. Having been an academic and I'm now a judge, I just want to point out that it's not only judges who are out of touch with popular culture. It's not only judges who can't recognise pop stars and football players. It's the lady in red.
Aileen Kavanagh, the University of Oxford. I have one quick question to Baroness Hale. I really enjoyed your lecture, and you posed at one point a judicial choice. And you said that that choice was between whether to develop the law or leave it alone. And we see this in a number of cases, and cases where this is difficult. I wondered, I'm a public lawyer, and what I see in some of the cases coming out of the UK Supreme Court, sometimes under the Human Rights Act, is that a halfway house is found sometimes. Not that the courts would say, we will develop the law or we will do nothing, but rather adopting an intermediary role where courts find ways of trying to stimulate and provoke and prod and nudge the legislature to do its job. And I wondered what you would have to say about that. And the other question refers to the caution and the question you hovered over this issue of whether there's too much caution. And Nicholson is a big case that public lawyers are talking about because there was a holding back there from issuing a declaration of incompatibility and just relying on an informal prod, a kind of nudge, well, we think you should think about this, but we're not going to issue a declaration of incompatibility. So I wondered what you thought about both of those types of intermediary solutions to this dilemma that you posed. Thank
you. Well, of course, any judge who's decided that they're not going to develop the law, public or private law, in a direction that the judge thinks is desirable, is likely to say in the judgment, this is a matter for Parliament, I hope Parliament gives it its early attention. They keep on doing that. Parliament keeps on doing nothing. So although, of course, it can be done, there is still the problem of what you do if Parliament does nothing. And I don't really have a lot of doubt. Of course, Nicholson, it was a human rights case. And who knows? They raise a completely different set of problems for us, dilemmas for us. But I would be very surprised if there weren't another Nicholson case with the evidence in order before too long. And then we would have to see what we would have to see.
Can I come in on this point about legislative inaction? So to give you an extreme example, you go to the United States in the 50s and 60s. So what the US Supreme Court is presented with in the United States in the 50s and 60s is grotesque, utterly grotesque injustice in the southern states. So what they've got is, there's a case called Loving in Virginia, Well, what happens in Loving in Virginia, you have a law which makes it a criminal offence to marry outside of your own race. And so you'd best have somebody being prosecuted under this legislation, under this statute. And the question, the Supreme Court of the United States is presented with the idea, the question, well, what do you do? And in a way, what's the problem is that the legislative process in the South was completely sclerotic. You have, you know, Jim Crow laws, and you have a position where the legislature is simply not going to address this grotesque injustice. And so then what do you do? You know, you're the judge, and you're sat there with this grotesque injustice. You've got a position where you know the legislature is going to do nothing about it. And what do you do? Well, what notoriously the Supreme Court did was they take the due process clause in their constitution and strike down the legislation using a due process clause. Now, if you read that with an English legislative interpretation eyes, you go, how on earth are you doing that? This provision doesn't in any way mandate your striking down of this legislation. This is to be that giving people due process, not about the substantive laws which you have. Yeah? But that's the temptation to say, well, because the legislature is inactive, you know, we're going to be the ones who intervene. Now, in a way, you might say, well, that was justified in the United States. But the end result was that what happened was the judiciary got politicised. So the result of a decades was we have arguments over who it is who's going to be on their ultimate appellate court, and you know full well, every single case, you know full well how the outcome of the case is going to go, because you can just count off who's the Liberals and who's the Conservatives. You know which way they're going to jump, and they just fight over who's going to go onto the court. Now, I really don't want to be in that position. Yeah? So in a way, Baroness L is the most commonly known of our, you know, members of the Supreme Court. I want them all to be anonymous. I don't want people to know who these people are at all, because they shouldn't care who they are, because it shouldn't matter who they are. And that temptation to intervene, the danger of it is you end up with where they've got to in the United States.
Thank you. Hector McQueen.
I'll show it.
I would much rather hear Rob's answer.
All right, well, if they'd done it, there would have been all sorts of unintended consequences which weren't before the court. So, for example, our entire law of insolvency is predicated on the existence of the penalties doctrine. So if you didn't have the penalties doctrine, what people would do would they'd write into their contracts, if you do not perform, I get £100 million by way of damages. And the reason you'd be writing that in was because you could then prove in the insolvency for £100 million rather than the £50, which would be your ordinary damages, and thereby scoop the pot and overreach everybody else. So that our entire law of insolvency is predicated on the existence of the penalties doctrine. So that one of the dangers of judges radically overturning bodies of the common law is that there are other areas of law which are predicated on its existence, and unfortunately they're not always able to predict what they will be, and I bet they didn't have that point before them when that was put in argument, and frankly that's a fatal argument to the idea that you should simply go around abolishing this. They should never have touched it, which fortunately they never did. Hooray.
Lady in light blue top now.
Rosemary Upmuti from Reading. Lady Hale, I'd like to take you up on a little throwaway comment you made towards the beginning of your address when you were talking about the disadvantages of prenuptial agreements. And you said one of the problems is that people embarking on marriage are not exactly sure what you said, but not in the most commercially rational mind, something like that. And then you said, at least I hope they are not. And I wonder if this is not playing into a stereotype which is both old-fashioned and undesirable. I'm quite prepared to believe that when we fall in love, we're sometimes irrational and we make silly decisions and we make concessions and so on. But these days, when people get married, it seems to me, it's often after years of experience of the partner. Often, always, I think, when the first flush of romance has passed, and often for practical reasons. And it would seem to me that if you're embarking on what's essentially a legal contract, you should not only be aware of its terms, which, if you get divorced, can be quite uncertain, but that it's much better that you should be talking about them, making agreements, and getting proper advice, of course, and thinking about all the contingencies, like there might be children, you know, someone might die or be disabled, and that you might break up. And that actually, as long as we go along with this idea, which is just repeated in textbook after textbook, about how, especially with unmarried couples, but also with married couples, that people just are blinded by love and don't make decisions, then we're always going to be looking to the law to rescue us. Us means women, usually. And that what we really want is not, I hope they are being financially rational when they form these legal binds. So what do you think?
I think that was question, comment, and discussion.
I'm not happy about this.
Well, no, of course not. Well, I'm very sorry I'm not coming to the family law section where we could have this out properly. But would you have one law for those who were getting married for love without any previous cohabitation or without much in the way of previous cohabitation, and one law for those who were in a rational frame of mind. What you have to do is to have proper information, proper disclosure, and proper independent legal advice. That's what you need to do, because that is a safeguard against people being misinformed, which of course they may very well be, people being blinded by their desire to go through this, whether their desire is one that has emerged many years after the relationship or whether it's a much earlier one. I do not myself believe that family relationships are entirely governed by reason. I think it would be a sorry state of affairs if they were. One of the things that I hated the most as a family division judge was being told that this parent is not rational about her children. I don't think parents should be rational about their children. And so I very much hope that family relationships are not commercial relationships and that they continue not to be purely commercial relationships, whether it's the men or the women who are blinded or whether it's a same-sex couple or whatever. It matters not. They are a different sort of relationship from purely commercial ones.
Quite right. I was an idiot when I got married.
As well as
right. We have time for two more interventions. First, the gentleman in the pink shirt, and then Lady Justice Arden. Yep.
Tomas Joffe from the University of Aberdeen. For me, the main message is that the answer to these questions depends on two considerations, democratic legitimacy and institutional capacity. My slightly provocative question is that are judges or legal scholars are particularly well situated to make judgments on institutional capacity? And of course, there is an implicit statement in my question, so it is also a comment. So there is a paradox here that judges have to make decisions on institutional capacity, but I am quite skeptical that judges are the best persons, or legal scholars in general, are the best persons to make institutional decisions, because I think that institutional capacity is about epistemic considerations and motivational considerations. And I think that psychology, economics, political science, so they have a lot to say about these issues, perhaps more than legal scholarship. Thank you.
Well, you do, of course, make a very good case for leaving all lawmaking to the legislature, although I do not believe myself that legislatures are any more competent to make a lot of the judgments that they're called upon to make, of the nature that you're talking about. But they, too, are not solely guided by the evidence or the arguments or the principles or whatever. They're guided by a lot of other things, including, of course, what their constituents think and the particular system of elections which they happen to be subject to. I think there's a very interesting piece of work that probably has been done, but I've not seen it, on the effect of different electoral systems on the behaviour of legislators. But our first-past-the-post system in this country means that our parliamentarians have to be very conscious of what their particular constituents think, especially the more marginal their seat is. Whether those who are elected in other ways might be freer to form their judgments on the basis of the evidence and the arguments, I don't know, but I'd be very interested in that. Meanwhile, I come back to the point, if the judge has a case in which the question arises, however incompetent the judge feels to decide the case, and believe me, however confident we look and sound, most of the time we are very conscious of our own incompetence. We have to decide it. All we can do.
Before coming to Lady Jessand, can I just, it's perhaps a reaction to that last question, but it's also a reaction to, Rob makes a really important point about thinking carefully about incremental steps to change. But I think, in a sense, there is a danger the danger that he gives, but there is this one advantage of incremental steps, and that is that it's to do with the certainty, which was at the start of his talk, that if the court makes an incremental step, the legislature, who everybody here, we've all said we're all cynical about whether they'll do anything, but the legislature can stop it if they want to. It doesn't take away from his point, but I think one could say that what would have happened at the end when the last step's taken is going to be less unpredictable. So the argument from predictability is met. And I want to fit my last substantive comment has again to do with one of my great heroes, Lord Gough. And in his Maccabean lecture, he talked about the development of the common law principle as being kaleidoscopic, tiny changes, incremental steps, which if you see one's wrong, and the judges have done this, they then step back a little bit. And I don't think that's bad. It's not. It's messy, but it's not bad. I hand over to Lady Justice Arden.
Thank you very much indeed. It's been a tremendous session, and thank you both very much. But I just have a question for Robert, if I may, because I think sitting there, I heard you say, it didn't really matter who the judges were. Can I just say that that's not something with which I would agree, and I don't suppose my colleagues would. We're very committed to our job, but it's also very important that we have a diverse group of legal minds that bring to bear diverse experiences, and so that we can really thrash a question out before the answer is given. That's the way we produce well-tested and well-informed responses. So when you ask, is judge-made law legitimate, as you were doing, I would respectfully suggest that you need to think about the checks and balances in relation to judges and ensure that they are appointed in a manner which is objective and that on the basis of a broadly based definition of merit. But thank you all.
I think that the boss has said I've got to stop. I don't know, he's gone like that. I think wind it up, it must mean. I want to thank both our speakers for setting up this session tremendously. The comments, questions, and the discussion have been very good. So I thank you all, and we can now prepare our digestions for the dinner. Thank you.